For more on Iraq, we are joined from Washington by Michael O'Hanlon, Director of Foreign Policy Research at the Brookings Institute. Good morning to you, Michael.
Good morning. Nice to be with you.
Yes. So give us a bigger sense of what's happening here. The United States has invested so much in really building a government in Iraq. Right now, is that government in danger?
Well, the government is the danger in many ways. You know, the way I would put it is when people see the Iraqi army meltdown and wonder how that could be happening after all these years of U.S. investment, you have to remember politics trump military training. And right now, the units that are up in the north and west have basically dissolved because they did not want to fight for a man, Prime Minister Maliki, that many of them call now the Shia Saddam. They liken him to Saddam Hussein. They consider him to be a dictator who's only out for the well-being of his broader Shia community and then his specific cronies and clique. And in that context, you've seen Maliki drive all the Sunni virtually together. And they even tolerate now this al-Qaeda spinoff, this ISIS group, because they prefer working with that group to working with the government of their own country. When you're in that situation, you just can't be successful. So that's what's got to change in the first instance.
Michael, I mean, given, as you point out, the investment enormous investment we've made in Iraq, what difference can 300 military advisors make at this point?
Not very much in the absence of political reform. I mean, your question's spot on. I think all the missions that were being described just a moment ago by Mr. Kirby and others are appropriate, but I wouldn't expect them to do anything significant until we get political reform. So the purpose is almost preliminary. It's to size things up. It's to anticipate next steps. But those next steps cannot be successful, whether it's American forces or Iraqi forces carrying them out. And I'm sure it'll be primarily Iraqi forces under any circumstances. But they can't be successful until there's political reform that brings some of these Sunni leaders back into the government's camp.
We're also now seeing new recruitment video, basically a call on more Muslims to join, basically telling them they should be a part of this attack in both Syria and Iraq. What do you make of this new video? What are they trying to really do?
Well, as you mentioned, there are different videos out there. But the most important and encouraging thing in the last 24 hours is this Ayatollah al-Sistani, who, as you know, is the top Shia leader, the top religious leader in Iraq. And a couple of days ago, he encouraged many Shia men on the street to join militias to defend in a sectarian way part of the country. And now he's realized perhaps that was a mistake or was misinterpreted, and he seems to be calling for two things in a much more constructive way. One, for Maliki either to shape up or resign. And then secondly, for the Shia perhaps to volunteer to join the army or police, but not just to go off and fight radicals on their own. And so I think that kind of recruiting, that kind of video or commentary from the Ayatollah is potentially constructive, and we'll have to hope so.
Michael, very quickly, what do you think the odds of Maliki stepping aside are?
Pretty small, but I'm hoping that even if we fail in that, by having that conversation in the first place, we'll persuade him he's got to bring in some good Sunni and Kurds into his top leadership positions and restore the proper functioning of the Iraqi ministries of interior and defense and justice. Otherwise, there just can't be any real progress here.
All right. Michael O'Hanlon in Washington. Thank you, Michael.